Hi, this is Marshall Lytle of Bill Haley's Original Comets, and you're listening to Arnie Amber on the local radio station 590 AM, WMBS, Uniontown, Pennsylvania.
And Marshall, welcome to Oldies Unlimited. It is a pleasure to have a man of your caliber on with us today.
Well, thank you, Arnie. It's a pleasure to be with you and all your great listeners there in the Southwest Pennsylvania and wherever your station takes it.
Well, we had a chance to see you in early December at the Richard Nader show at Console Energy, and you were great.
Oh, well, thank you. I was just thrilled to be there with such a large number of people in the audience. My God, there were almost 10,000 people there, and it was really amazing.
How do you maintain your energy level?
Because well, I'm 78 years young right now, and I have a great attitude about life and what's going on in the world, and I'm going to rock till I drop, Arnie.
You are a singer, a songwriter, an yes. author, a movie star. What haven't you done yet?
Well, I still have a few things in my bucket that I wanted to do on my bucket list, and it's pretty amazing to be able to do what I do. I'm very lucky, a very lucky person to have so many wonderful people around me, and we got some great news. Yeah, one of my wonderful guys are leaving right now. My father-in-law is getting out of the van. We just had lunch with him, and he's 92.
Wow.
And he's sharp as a tack. And he's living in an assisted living facility, and they're taking good care of him here. But anyway, I am very lucky to have such wonderful people around me, and I got some great news the other day about a week or two after we did the show in Pittsburgh. I had a telephone call from Terry Stewart, who is the president and CEO of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland. And he said, Marshall, he says, I'm going to have some good news for you in a few days. And he winked at me, and I waited for a few days, and then finally I called him. I couldn't stand it anymore. And he said, well, get your bags packed, because on April 14th, you're going to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Great.
And so we talked for a bit, and he's going to induct all the original Comets, because Bill Haley was inducted in 1986, and they did not induct the Comets into the Hall of Fame. And he told me, he says, well, we're trying to right a wrong that was done back in 86 with not only yourselves but a few other people, and they're going to induct Buddy Holly's backing group, the Crickets, and James Brown's group called the Flames, and he said there'd be about 15 people that will be inducted over and above the ones that have already been chosen. But he said he didn't want to put it on the internet yet, waiting for the Hall of Fame to make their own big announcement about it. So anyway, I've let your listeners in on a little secret that's coming up in April of 2012.
Congratulations. It
well,
is an
you.
Honor that is long in coming, that should have been here back in 87 or so.
Yes, I agree, and it's sure going to be another feather in my cap to have that wonderful induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I've had a couple of other good things happen to me in the last year. Since I wrote my book, Still Rocking Around the Clock, my story of my life, I've had a writer in Hollywood read my book, and he has written a screenplay about it. And I just got the first draft of the screenplay that he wrote. He sent it to me yesterday over the internet, and I read it last night, and it's going to be a great, great story, and we're hoping that we can put it on film. So there might be in my future a motion picture about my life.
That would be interesting.
Oh, it would be. It would be. And, you know, it's a story of my early days with Bill Haley, how I met Bill, and all the things that happened during my years as Bill Haley in the Saddlemen, later to become Bill Haley in the Comets, and how that all took place is all going to be in the film. And I had another acting role last year. A dear friend of mine, Bertie Higgins, of Key Largo fame, back in the 80s, he had a big old hit record with Bogey and McCall.
I remember it well.
Just like Bogey and McCall. And Bertie has become a movie producer. He's got a production company called Key Largo Production Company. And his son, Julian Higgins, is a great movie director. We just did a film with that starred Tom Sizemore, and we filmed it here in Tampa, Florida, where the original screenplay was written about. Bertie Higgins himself, he grew up here in the little kind of a visitor town of Tarpon Springs, Florida. It's the second sponge capital of the world outside of Greece. This is the only place where people can dive down in the water and get sponges. And Bertie grew up here, and back in the 70s, Tarpon Springs was known in the drug world as the place to get drugs. And marijuana was distributed out of Tarpon Springs, Florida, back in the 70s. And Bertie was involved in that as he was growing up, and he knew all about it, and he wrote a great screenplay about the drug dealings in Florida called Through the Eye. And the eye means, in the drug business, a strip of water from between Cozumel, Mexico, and Cuba, about a 200-mile distance, where they fly airplanes underneath the radar at about 100 feet over the water, bringing their contraband into America by way of the Gulf of Mexico. And they would bring these bales of marijuana in and drop them off in the Gulf of Mexico designated spot. And they, shrimp boats would pick them up and bring them into Tarpon Springs for distribution. And Bertie Higgins wrote a great featured part in the movie for myself, and I play the part of a kingpin drug operator in Tarpon Springs, Florida. It's really good. I really enjoyed playing the role, but Tom Sizemore is quite an actor, and he has the starring role. He's always played most of his roles are, he plays a dirty cop, and that's what he played in this role, in this film, Through the Eye. And I won't give the story away, but when the film comes out, I hope a lot of your listeners will see it and go look at it. I play the part of Captain Morgan in the movie. I own an old rundown bar where the drug people hang out and stuff. But it's a very interesting movie, and it's been picked up by Lionsgate, I believe, is going to be the worldwide distributor of the movie. So we should get some action on that within the next month or two. And Through the Eye should be in the stores or in the theaters.
Sounds good. Okay, yeah. Take us back about 60 years. How did you get your start in rock and roll? I know that you were a disc jockey at one time, had your own radio show. Did that help lead?
Well, really a disc jockey. I had my own radio show, but it was a live show where I played and sang with my guitar. That's how I got hooked up with Bill. Bill Haley was a local attraction around Chester, Pennsylvania, where I was growing up. And Bill had a band in the late 40s called Bill Haley and the Four Aces of Western Swing. And he had a guitar player from West Virginia that needed a room. And my brother, Cliff, who did, just got out of the Navy, became friends with him from the local bar where he used to go and have a beer once in a while. And he brought the guitar player from Bill Haley's band to live with us at our house. My mother rented him a room. And so he used to sit around and practice every day. And I would listen and sit in and try to learn all that I could. And I'd go grab the old family guitar out of the closet and take it in a bedroom and try to learn what I just experienced. Tex King, that was his name, the guitar player, what he was doing. And so that's how I learned some songs. I learned some guitar chords. And pretty soon I got good enough where I could sing to the girls sitting on the steps. And I started entering some talent shows. And in 1949, I was on a talent show called Paul Whiteman's Talent Show from Philadelphia. And it was a national TV show. And I sang an old country song with just my guitar. And I didn't win the show, but another young girl from that area, her name was Diane Carroll. She went on to become quite a big star and made movies and all of that. So she was extremely good and very talented, and she won the talent show. But it didn't discourage me. I went on and kept trying to improve myself. And a guy from a radio station heard me one time, and he says, how about doing a little morning broadcast, 15 minutes every morning, and we'll put you on your own show. So I jumped at the chance, and for about a year or so, I was doing my broadcast at 7 o'clock in the morning, singing requests and things like that. And one day, Bill Haley walked into the studio and asked me, he says, hey, he says, my bass player just quit, Marshall. He says, I'd like to have you come and be my bass player with my band. And he had changed the name of his band at that time. It was called Bill Haley and the Saddlemen. And they were playing locally in a lot of nightclubs and different venues. So I said, well, hell, Bill, I don't play the bass. I play the guitar. He said, heck, I can teach you how to play that thing in about a half an hour, and you can pick up the rest of it on the job. I said, well, let's try it. So we went out to his radio station where he had a bass fiddle, and he grabbed a hold of it and says, this is what I want you to play. And he played a shuffle beat, which was a clickety-click sound. By pulling the strings and slapping the neck of the bass, it can doom ba 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 doom like that, and so he showed me how to do it, and I grabbed the bass and I started beating on it, and I said, heck, I think I can do that, Bill, and he says, well, get yourself a bass fiddle and. Come on to work with me tonight at the Twin Bars over in Gloucester, New Jersey. So I said, okay. And I went down and I bought me an old bass fiddle. Went to work with him that night. I started to learn. Started getting blisters all over my fingers because I didn't have any calluses at that particular time. And I gritted my teeth and eventually I got calluses on my fingers from playing that you could almost drive nails in them. And Bill, he played bass and sang. And I sang and I played guitar and Bill played the bass. And then when Bill, I played the bass. But we didn't have any drums back in those days. And Bill was always saying, play it louder, Marshall, play it louder. Because I was basically the rhythm section for the band, along with Bill on the rhythm guitar. Our instrumentation was steel guitar, accordion, and rhythm guitar and bass. And then we got lucky and we recorded a song in 1952 called We're Gonna Rock This Joint Tonight. And it was given to us by a disc jockey that was playing rhythm and blues music on the local radio station where we were broadcasting an hour show every day in Chester. From 12 noon to 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we'd do a live one-hour show and, sing requests and advertise where we were going to be working. And this local disc jockey brought us a record and said, Bill, this is about the most popular song on my show. He says, and it's really good. You ought to learn it. And he gave him a copy of I'm Gonna Rock This Joint Tonight. So we started doing it in the nightclub, and the sailors and the people that were in the audience just loved it. Bill says, well, we're going to record this one. So we recorded Rock This Joint, and the owner of Essex Records wanted us to go promote it in Cleveland, Ohio, because that was one of the record-making cities. If you had a hit in Cleveland, it would spread all across America. And we went there, and we did a disc jockey interview with a new DJ there, known as King of the Moon Dogs. His name was Alan Seed. And Alan Root, and it was Bill Haley and the Saddlemen with Roger's Joint. And when the record played, Alan had a switch on the wall that he could turn the microphone on and off whenever he wanted to. And while the record was playing, he turned the mic on and he kept yelling, rock and roll, everybody, rock and roll. And the telephone at the radio station just started ringing off the hook. And people kept calling up and they'd say, well, play that rock and roll song again. And he played Rock This Joint about, I think, 10 or 12 times that night. And I really think that was the night that rock and roll was born. And I was there, so, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to put on a different hat now.
Okay.
And if you would play disc jockey and introduce Rock the Joint, we'll get it up at playing for our listening audience.
Well, all right. Hey, everybody, this is a song that we recorded in 1952. And this one is called, Hey, Rock This Joint.
We're gonna tear down the mailbox, rip up the floor, smash out the windows and knock down the door. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock this joint tonight. Well, 6 times 6 is 36. I ain't gonna hit for 6 more licks. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint, we're gonna rock, rock this joint, we're gonna rock this joint tonight. Do the sugarfoot rag, side by side, a flying low and a flying wide, we're gonna rock. Rock this joint, we're gonna rock. Rock this joint, we're gonna rock. Rock this joint, we're gonna rock this joint tonight. reel. Just let your feet know how you feel. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock this joint tonight. Six is 36. I ain't gonna hit for six more licks. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock, rock this joint. We're gonna rock this joint tonight.
Mr. Marshall Lytle with us from Bill Haley's Comets and their first claim to fame, Rock This Joint. Now, you were playing the bass fiddle, or stand-up
yeah.
bass, and no
yeah.
drums on there, and basically the same solo as that would become famous a couple years later with Rock Around the Clock.
Yes. Danny Cedrone, the guitar player, was a session player, and he had his own group around the Philadelphia area called the Esquire Boys. And Danny was a favorite guitar player of Bill Haley, because we used him on most all of the recordings, with the exception of a few that Danny couldn't arrange to be on. But when we did the Rock Around the Clock session 2 years later, on April 12th of 1954, we had a song that the A&R man from Decca Records was part owner of the song, and he was pushing it at us to record, and we had never heard the song until we arrived at the studio. When we got there, he said, "This is what I want you to record today. We have a 3-hour record session, and so let's get to work on this." And it's called 13 Women and Only One Man in Town. And we had never heard of the song, and we had to build an arrangement on it that took us 2.5 hours to get it down and finished, and where the A&R man says, "Okay, that's a wrap." And then he said, "Okay, now you guys can do that rock thing that you're going to do." He didn't even know what to call it. And by the way, on the recording of Rock Around the Clock, it says, Foxtrot. Vocal, Bill Haley, right on the label, because they didn't know what to call it, so they called it a foxtrot. And on the song of Rock Around the Clock, you'll notice that the same guitar solo that was on Rock This Joint that we just played, Danny Cedrone played it on Rock Around the Clock, because we only had 30 minutes to record Rock Around the Clock. And Danny was not at the rehearsal the night before our record session, where we had rehearsed Rock Around the Clock. And Danny was kind of fishing around for a guitar solo to play. And I said, "Danny, we only got 30 minutes to record this thing. Why don't you try that great guitar solo that you played on Rock This Joint?" He said, "Do you think it'll fit?" I said, "Well, it's a 12-bar blues. Yeah, I think it'll work just fine. Let's try it." So we tried a take on it, and he played that solo, and it went just perfect. And we did one extra take, and they put those two takes together and created the master that became the big hit on Rock Around the Clock.
And did you have any idea that 60 years later or 58 years later, it would still be the national anthem of rock and roll?
Oh, I know. I'm absolutely amazed at the success that the song had. I was told in 2000, the year 2000, that it had reached 80 million in sales worldwide. And, of course, I made a big amount of money off of it. I made $41.25. That was my pay for a 3-hour record session in 1954 in the city of New York, Musicians Union Scale. That's what all the musicians made for recording in those days. 3 hours for $41.25.
And
but anyway, James Myers that wrote and published the song had told me that he made $12 million from Rock Around the Clock. And by the way, it has been in over 50 motion pictures, and it's been recorded over 500 by 500 different artists, and it's got a big resume on its own. Just Rock Around the Clock. And, you know, 99% of everybody on earth has heard it at one time or another. And he told me at that time, he says, you know, Rock Around the Clock is playing at least 1,000 times right now on different stations and nightclubs and different things throughout the world. He says, at any given time, that's Rock Around the Clock is playing. And so I said, wow, that's really something. Yeah.
Well, what effect do you think Happy Days had on bringing it back into the public eye?
Happy Days made it a hit all over again. Yeah, and when they put it on Happy Days, the kids that watched it went out and bought it. And it sold another million or two or three or five or ever how many. But with 80 million in sales, it was a monster hit.
Okay, you were the first really stand-up bass guitar player to play in rock and roll. Joby Malden from the Crickets a few years later, but you were the first one to do some of the antics, so to speak. How did that happen?
I created the antics in 1953 in a nightclub we were playing in Wildwood, New Jersey. We were doing a kind of an afternoon jam session where people could come in their bathing suits and shorts and just hang out with, you know, very, very different kind of a dress code. And so they would come in there and have their beer, and we'd have a jam session. And we started playing an instrumental one day. Joey, our saxophone player, he would go out in the audience and start honking at the girls, and I while he did that, I said, well, let me see what I can do. And it was kind of like a battle of let's see what we can do to excite the crowd. So I stood up on the bass fiddle, and the crowd went crazy. And then I got back and I put it up like I was playing a guitar. And the next thing I'd do, I'd lay down on my back and put it up on my feet, and the saxophone player'd come up and he'd sit on the bass, and I'd slide him across the floor, and it became a major part of our act. And so we even did it in a motion picture, 1954. It was called Roundup of Rhythms. And so it's still, people started copying me, doing my antics, and
okay.
And so it was a great time in my life of being able to do all that kind of stuff, and then we started touring Europe about 1960 in the 60s, we all kind of went our separate ways. I went into the real estate business, and for 25 years, we were out of show business. Then in 1987, we had a reunion where all the original Comets got back together again for a big show in Philadelphia at the Academy of Music. And they were giving Dick Clark a star on the street. And Dick Richards, drummer, was in the acting business, and he knew the producer of that show. And the producer of that show said, hey, can you get all the original Comets back together for this this big show in Philadelphia that we're doing with Dick Clark? And so Dick called all of us, and we all said, yeah, we can do it. It was just a one-time shot. We were just going to go and do a couple of songs and forget it. But it turned out to be a lot more than that. We did the show, and then we had a young man named David Hirschberg. He was a fan of the Comets for many years, and he said, he came backstage and he says, oh, you guys were so good. He says, I got some connections over in England. He says, if I can get you a show over there, would you guys do it? And we said, oh, yeah, why not? And we never thought that he would ever come up with anything, because as far as we were concerned, you know, we were a dead issue. But from doing that show, we sure found out that a lot of people still remembered the Comets, even though Bill Haley had passed on. We went to England, and we had 3,000 people show up and paid over $50 a head to get in to see us. And there were dozens of bass players that came to pay homage to me, and I was just absolutely in awe of the fact that they put me kind of on a pedestal as their hero. And it's been a wonderful ride for us to go and play in Europe. The slap bass in Europe is a lot more popular than it is here in the States, because all the rockabilly bands all over England and in Europe, they all play the slap bass the way I used to do it. And they all do my antics, and they all wanted me to sign the bass fiddles that they played. So my signature is on hundreds of basses in New York, in England, and in Europe. And it's a real honor to me that they would do that. And one of the most touching scenes I ever had in my life, Arnie, was we were doing a show in Paris, France. And after the show, we had an autograph table where they would let people come in one at a time and come up and talk to us. And a young man came up to me once, and he put his arm down on the table, and right on his forearm was a tattoo of me standing on my bass fiddle. And I looked at it, and right underneath the photograph was my signature. I said, my God, man, I know how you got the picture. You took that picture with a camera, but how did you get my signature on your arm? He said, you don't remember, but last year when you were here in Paris, I came through the line and I just tucked my arm down and I asked you to sign my arm, and you did. And he says, and I went home and I had my pictures developed, and I said, my God, wouldn't that be a great picture of Marshall to have tattooed on my arm? So he took one of the photographs of me standing up on the bass fiddle, and he took it to his tattoo parlor, and they copied it and put it right on his arm and tattooed my signature right underneath it. And I looked at him and I said, why in the world would you ever do something like that? And he said, you don't understand, do you? And he said, I'm a bass player, and you're the most copied bass player in the world. You're my hero. so I wanted you to be with me the rest of my life. And tears came to my eyes, and I just couldn't believe it, that someone would do that for me. A little old bass player from Chester, Pennsylvania, that played on Rock Around the Clock and a few other hit records along with Bill Haley.
Okay, tell us real quick.
So it's kind of exciting.
Okay, tell us real quick about your book, Still Rocking Around the Clock.
Well, 2 years ago, well, 3 years ago now, we were in Branson, Missouri, and my niece, who is my brother's daughter, had a friend who was a writer, and she called me up one day and says, "Hey, my boyfriend wants to maybe do a book of your life." He said, "Would you be interested?" And I said, "Absolutely, I'd be interested." So we got together. His name is Michael Rush, and Michael got together with me, and he said, "Put your information on a tape recorder and record, you know, as many hours as you want to talk." So I started talking on tapes, and I think I filled up more than 12 or 15 hours of material where I talked about my life and how my life began and where I was born and where I grew up and how I became associated with Bill Haley and my whole life story. And so he took that and had it transcribed on paper. And we edited the parts that I had talked about that were not too pertinent to Bill Haley, but most of the material on there is the story of my life and my years with Bill Haley and the Comets, and it's going to be made into a motion picture, I'm hoping, because the screenplay is turning out to be very, very good. It's a good story, and you know, it would make an interesting film. That's kind of how that all took place, and people can still buy my book on Amazon.com, and just type in the words "Still Rockin'," and my book will pop up. And also found out a week ago, the hardcover, the regular book is $15, but they can download it now on Kindle. For $9.99, still rocking on Kindle at Amazon.com. And I guess you could get it at Barnes & Noble, different stores and things like that. But anyway, I'm kind of excited about what the future looks like for me. And by the way, I'm doing a show on February 3rd. In Clear Lake, Iowa, going over to celebrate the winter dance party. Buddy Holly and
the Big Bopper, Richie Valens.
The Big Bopper and Richie Valens. That's where they took off from the night they were killed in February of 1959. And Pat Boone is on the night after I'm on. There's a whole big roster of people that are going to be on I think it starts Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. It's a big week of festivities in Clear Lake, Iowa. Cold. I was there about 5 years ago. We did a show there, and it was 14 below zero.
Okay, let me ask you one other thing, too. Tell us about the movie that you were in with Elvis, the Pod Piper of Cleveland.
Oh, yeah, that was done in 1955. The number one disc jockey after Alan Freed left Cleveland was a guy named Bill Randall. Bill Randall was the first person that ever introduced Elvis on national television. A lot of people think that it was the Ed Sullivan Show. Well, it wasn't. And pull that arm up. Okay. In 1956, January, Bill Ramble introduced Elvis to the national television audience on the Dorsey Brothers television show. And we did a show with Bill Ramble at a high school in Cleveland called Brooklyn High School. And on that show was Pat Boone, Bill Haley and the Comets, the Four Lads, and a young singer from up in Canada, and a young person that not too many people had heard about. His name was Elvis Presley. And Elvis was not a star yet. He hadn't done any national TV shows, but he was promoted by Bill Ramble. And so we did this show at the Brooklyn Theater, Brooklyn High School, and it was filmed. And the movie was basically a stage show made into a movie. And Elvis was not the star of it, and they showed the movie was made, and the film was never shown but one time to the people that were in the audience at the high school, at the Brooklyn High School. They showed the film one time, and then the movie disappeared. It just nobody knows what happened to it, and nobody else ever saw it. And there's a kind of a rumor going around that Colonel Tom Parker had bought the movie and destroyed it because Elvis wasn't the star of the film, and he was wanting Elvis to be a superstar. And, of course, he did become a superstar after that, but that was one of the rumors. So maybe someday somebody will come up and say, here's a copy of the movie that was done in Cleveland. It's called The Pied Piper of Cleveland was the title of the movie. And it was the story about Bill Ramble, a disc jockey, that discovered young talent and made them stars. So that... that was an interesting event in my life.
Well,
and of course, I spent a couple of hours with Elvis in 1960 after he got out of the Army. I was in Las Vegas at the time, and Elvis was backstage just hanging out with a bunch of entertainers. And I happened to be there, and one of my partners and I, we were backstage, and Elvis gathered us all around and was showing us some karate moves that he was very good at. He held a black belt, so he knew what he was talking about. And he was showing us how to put your thumb into somebody's eyeball and pull it out, you know, just totally disabled him with a karate move. And during this time, he asked me to hold his wristwatch while he gave us a demonstration. And I held his wristwatch, and I naturally turned it over and read the back of it. And on the back of his watch, it said, "To Elvis Presley, congratulations on the sale of your 79 millionth record from RCA Victor." Now, this was 1960.
Unbelievable.
That he had only been a star for 4 years. From 1956 until 1960, 79 million records. Unbelievable, isn't it?
You're right. This hour has gone too quick. I want to thank you so much for taking the time to reminisce with me. And before I let you go, I'm going to have you play disc jockey one more time. And
okay.
If you would introduce your biggest claim to fame, with Rock Around the Clock, we will get it up and running for our listening audience.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, here's a song that we recorded on April 12th, 1954. Dick Clark calls it the National Anthem of Rock and Roll, but actually it's the International Anthem of Rock and Roll. You know what it is? It's called Rock Around the Clock.
One, two, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on. Join me, home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock till broad daylight. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. When the clock strikes two, three, and four. Chimes ring 5, 6, and 7. We'll be right in seventh heaven. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock till broad daylight. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Oh, when it's 8, 9, 10, 11, 2, I'll be going strong, and so will you. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock till broad daylight. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight.
Bill Haley and the Comets. Our special thanks to Marshall Lytle for taking time.